Hi, everyone. So I think we should introduce ourselves a little in case some of you were not here yesterday. So, and also I didn't get to introduce myself anyway. So I am Bruce Perrins, and I've just been having this great time in the open source world for a long, long time. I did my first talk, I believe, in 1996, and I have been working on open source as open source since 1987, and actually released my first open source or free software in 1981 when I was working at a computer graphics laboratory. And back then we didn't have the licenses, and we didn't really have the sharing concept that we have now, but we had something called net.sources on Usenet. And because we didn't have the internet, we had modems that dialed up other places and sent all of our emails around every night. And of course, it was all very slow. So we had news groups, which were sort of like forums, and you could put source code up on those news groups. And they were not known for being things of high quality, and we didn't have any of the collaboration that we have now with the internet. So I worked for 12 years at Pixar. I have credits on Toy Story 2 and A Bug's Life, and worked on a lot of films that are not credited. And worked at Hewlett-Packard as the first open source officer in the company. I have a book series called the Bruce Perrins Open Source Series, and that is 24 books. We made them before Creative Commons, and so we used a open publication license because there were no Creative Commons licenses to use, but it was open source. And we published the PDFs for the books online sometime after the books came out. And we made money, even though we shared the PDFs with those books with everyone. We made money on 23 of the 24 books. And that was with Prentice Hall, which is a very well-known publisher. Since then, I've been an evangelist all over the world for free software and open source and subsequently open hardware. I know many people in English call it open source hardware, and of course you have your own name for it in Portuguese, but there was this person who coined a term, free libre open source software, and the acronym for that was FLOSS, which is something you use to clean your teeth. And so I decided that I would not use long acronyms, so I just say open hardware. I have two companies. One is called Algorand, and Algorand makes a software-defined radio transceiver. It's not done yet. Our first customers will be ham radio operators, and our customers after that will be the land mobile market. That is anyone who needs to communicate for business or government without infrastructure. So the public utilities use that, the police, the firemen, all of the disaster authorities. My other business is the one that makes money. Algorand does not make money yet because our product isn't done. It's called Legal Engineering. And Legal Engineering is a consultancy where I help lawyers and their clients understand open source and also all kinds of technological issues around software. Because you can't get a lawyer to read source code, even if they have an engineering degree. And very often, there's a disconnect between the lawyers and the engineers in a company. You know, how do the engineers keep from infringing and violating open source licenses? Well, I help them figure that out. And where a company has infringed, I clean it up. So I help companies that are GPL violators become not GPL violators anymore. So with that, I'll give the mic to Javier.
Hi, so my name is Javier Serrano. I work in the European Laboratory for Particle Physics in Geneva, Switzerland. CERN is the acronym. I started getting involved with open source hardware in 2006 when I was asked to start coordinating the hardware and timing section in the controls group of the accelerators at CERN. So in this group, there are two teams, one which designs hardware and the other one which develops the low-level software support for that hardware in the form of Linux device drivers and associated libraries. And I noticed very quickly that there was a big divide in the ability to share information and to bring in extra help from outside and to collaborate with companies among these two different groups. And I set out to try to provide for the hardware team a similar environment to what the free software people had in collaboration with many friends and colleagues, of course. So we identified a number of challenges that we had to solve. Among those were the need for a place on the web to share designs, the need for a solid legal basis, the need for free software tools to be able to design hardware and to place those designs in a repository where people can get them, modify them, etc. The need to identify good business models with companies, and all these things we've been working on since 2006, and we are in the middle of that journey, maybe a bit further down the middle. So we're quite happy of the progress so far, but there are still many challenges. And it's great to be here with you to discuss with you.
So everyone can see our first question. What good has open hardware done for society so far? Why don't you start?
So my answer will be a bit underwhelming. I tend to see software and hardware as ultimately not that different. And the more hardware design evolves, hardware design is evolving very fast, the discipline, the more they look alike, in my opinion. Except that what's happening in hardware happened a number of years, like 20 years ago in software. So there is a lag, and with this question, I feel a bit like as if somebody had asked the question to a free software advocate in the beginning of the 90s. So you could see that it was a good thing, but you could not see the huge impact that it has had today. So open source hardware, there are many success stories of people already enjoying all these freedoms to share, and learning a lot and collaborating with companies and with other groups, but not to the level that it would affect the everyday life of the average person. So we have beautiful stories, for example, in the domain of prosthetic hands designed in collaboration and printed with 3D printers. And these are communities, and there are many such communities which are already enjoying this, among which I work in one of them. I work in the controls and data acquisitions of big physics facilities, and we're already experiencing all these things. But I think it's a bit early to say what the impact will be. But as I say, I think software is not that different from hardware, and what we've seen with software makes us think that the impact of open source hardware will be phenomenal.
So, moving to the next question. Unlike free and open source software, in open hardware, we need the components to take off. So, what are the benefits for the components?
Okay, I just wanted to remind people, if you have any sort of question that pops in your mind, just wave. And I think we'll be very happy to detour from the flow of prepared questions. So, yes, I think open hardware can be very important, and it's already important for especially small and medium-sized companies. And those companies, as you probably know, are very important for the economy, and that's why they receive, very often in countries, they receive a special treatment because they are closer to the citizens, they are in the real economy, they are very important economic actors. Very little of what they do is not geared at the real economy. So they are very important, but they are sometimes at a disadvantage, or always at a disadvantage, in a proprietary world, because they cannot build upon a pile of pre-existing proprietary developments like big proprietary companies can do. On the other hand, if they are in an open source paradigm, they are on a more level field to play and to try to compete with other commercial players. So I think for small companies, it can be very important. It will be very important. It's already very important for many of them. I also think that these companies, sometimes they, for what they need to do, a given product, they might be lacking some talents. And it will be easier for them to go and fish that talent for a particular project. And what we have seen already happening is that this can happen even between a company and its clients. So the clients themselves sometimes become part of the development team. And this works very well because clients are empowered. Clients who are in design are quite frequent as well, and they are, you know, often as competent or more competent than the companies. Another thing that I see coming is, and that I wish for, is a customer-driven change of paradigm. So people noticing that open source hardware and free software are good for them, are in their interests, and deciding to pay money to buy that, assigning value to the open sourcedness and being ready to pay for that. And in that respect, I also see a benefit to the companies who will which will offer that service, because they will have this type of clients.
So I agree with Javier. I think it will be the disruptive new companies that lead the adoption, just as it was with open source. So once upon a time, there was a very small company called Google that started with a check of about $200,000 from a man named Jim Clark. And Google built upon open source, and they couldn't really afford to build on anything else. And of course, they collected more investment as they went on. But all of the infrastructure of all of the now huge, giant, disruptive internet companies is an open source infrastructure. In fact, the main investor in Amazon.com talks about just how crazy it was to invest in a company that depended on PHP. And but he did so. And he won on that deal. And so we have a history which I think we can apply just as easily to open hardware. And I do a lot of work in radio. And I have been working on software-defined radio where we actually build hardware for the software-defined radio, just less hardware than if we did everything in analog. And one of the things that we've done is we've created a digital voice codec, which takes your voice and puts it into 1,200 bits per second. So very low bandwidth, reproduces clear voice. I believe that my telephone at that rate could record me for the rest of my life and not run out of memory. And one of our questions was, well, how do we get the big radio companies to use our new codec? Well, even though it had much higher performance, and we also built radio modems that also had much higher performance, they weren't interested. And what they did instead was all of these radio companies, ICOM, Yasuo, Kenwood, they all came out with a different way to put digital voice on the radio. And they all tried to own the entire market all for themselves by making themselves incompatible with the makers of all the other radios. It's really crazy. So the only way to fix it, and believe me, the customers are annoyed, the only way to fix it is to start a new small company that doesn't try to own the whole market and tries to do something based on open source and to some extent open hardware. And my company is doing that algorithm, and we are trying to beat Yasuo, Kenwood, and ICOM in the market by giving everyone a way to be compatible with us, even those three companies, when they won't allow anyone to be compatible with them. So I think it's going to be that sort of disruptive thing that gets open hardware into business, and that we cannot count on the big conventional companies to do it, and we should not wait for them. You can add to that if you want.
I think this is, of course, a very common pattern that in a world of incompatible options, an open source implementation emerges and becomes a de facto standard. This is something that we have seen in the software world, and of course there's no reason why it should be different in the hardware world. I see a third question. Is anybody? Oh yeah. Maybe grab a
the codec formats, how successful have you been in disseminating that and so forth?
So the question was about codec formats, I'm sorry.
Yeah, the codec you developed.
Yes.
You're trying to disseminate, so how successful have you been?
Oh, okay. So the question was, how successful was I at making an open source codec? Well, first of all, I am innumerate by the standards of the engineers in the audience. I actually went to communication arts school and learned how to be a filmmaker. So sometimes I need engineers and mathematicians to help me. And in the case of the codec, I found one named David Rowe, and he is an Australian ham radio operator. And he actually has a PhD in digital voice coding. So his thesis was in that. Go on.
Another question. I don't doubt that you have technical means and you were technically successful. I was more interested in like how many radio stations did you get to adopt the
Okay, so this would be two-way radios, not broadcast stations. And so far, the only people who are using it are the ham radio operators and people in governments. And the governments we actually had problem with because we had, for example, the government of Pakistan and their government radio institute told us that they were trying to make an encrypted, secure radio transceiver using our codec. And we had to tell them, well, you know, we're a ham radio project and an open source project. And if I help you with this, I am violating a law called ITAR, which is about munitions, the transfer of weapons from one country to another. The United States puts many technologies that are useful to the military under that law. If I make everything open source, I'm okay under that law. But if I actually help the military of other nations, we get the project in trouble. So obviously, they can use open source, and we know that they're out there, but we very politely ask them to stay off of our mailing list. So how successful have I been in getting the codec into commercial radios? There is one coming out from another manufacturer which will have it. It's a walkie-talkie, and it will be useful for police and firemen and things like that. And my own company is also making products like that, but so far not successful at all. Do we have more questions? Should we go on to number three?
Okay, go to number three. Why would hardware design adopt the TAPR or open hardware license or the reserved open hardware license instead of Creative Commons share alike license?
Let me explain for a minute. TAPR, T-A-P-R, is the Tucson Amateur Radio Project, Packet Radio Project, and they are radio hams, amateur radio operators, who started working on digital communications in the 1980s. And one of them is a very brilliant guy named John Ackerman. He is vice president of intellectual property for NCR, a computer manufacturer. And he is a time nut, which means that he, as a hobbyist, works on very precise time and frequency measurement and has in his home instruments that you would only otherwise find at Javier's Atomic Laboratory. And John, as an attorney, worked on making the TAPR open hardware license for products that TAPR was actually making for radio hams. And I assisted with this another ham radio operator who's also in open source named B. Dale Garby, who works for Hewlett Packard. He assisted on that license as well. And so the question is, why would we use a open hardware specific license or the CERN open hardware license, which Javier will explain, instead of a Creative Commons share-alike license? So I'm going to let Javier start on explaining that, and then I'm going to throw water on his argument.
First of all, I would like to acknowledge the figure of John Ackerman as well. I met him as a time nut before meeting him as a lawyer, and he's an incredible individual. And very generous as well, because the TAPR open hardware license predates the CERN open hardware license, and John helped us a lot to understand the concepts, the reasons why he was trying to do this. So it was really a very useful thing for us. The reason, in my opinion, why it's better to use the TAPR or the CERN open hardware license than using the Creative Commons share alike license is that these two licenses, they take into account that the documentation, and documentation in this license lingo is the design files, are going to eventually be used to make hardware. That's the key difference. Okay, Creative Commons does not make any assumption on what the utility of the document is. And these two other licenses are written with design files for hardware in mind. And one of the things that happens in the hardware world is that there are patents. And both of these licenses give a patent license to the licensee. That means that if I design something and I hold patents regarding that design, if I publish using the CERN Open Hardware License or the Tapper Open Hardware License, I promise the people who are going to receive those design files licensed under those licenses that I will not sue them for infringement of that patent. So it's reassuring for people who receive those design files because there's not that risk. Okay, that's one key difference. There's another thing in the case of the CERN Open Hardware License that I would like to mention. Licenses are used often to foster a certain type of behavior. For example, in the case of GPL, it's to encourage people to share back their improvements. And one of the biggest challenges in open source hardware is to ensure that people who receive hardware receive the design files or receive access to the design files along with the hardware. Okay? And this is important if we are going to enable these people to have a number of freedoms with their hardware, including understanding how it works, including modifying it, building it. So in my opinion, it's a good goal to have, to try to ensure that the recipient of hardware has access to the design files. Now, there are tools in the legal world to try to achieve that goal. And the CERN Open Hardware License, in my opinion, among the hardware licenses, is the one that comes closest at ensuring that that can happen. Now, there are limitations in the hardware world, legal limitations. We will probably discuss more about the reach of copyright, how much it covers. Or maybe I should rewind. Should I explain how a license works, how licensing works?
Let me try.
Okay. So you will do it. You will do it better than me. So in my opinion, that's a worthy goal to have. And the CERN Open Hardware License comes closest to achieving that goal. And in my opinion, achieves that goal in a number of cases, in a number of types of hardware. So those are the two main reasons why I think these licenses are better than the Creative Commons family of licenses.
So when we talk about Creative Commons is not just one license. It's a whole bunch of variations. And actually, very few of those variations are open source under the open source definition. So I'll notice, for example, that many makers of 3D printers who say that their 3D printer is open source put on their schematic the Creative Commons attribution, share alike, but non-commercial license. Okay, there's the NC at the end. And when they put a license that says non-commercial on their schematic, it's not open source and it's not open hardware. Okay, if you only say, you know, you can do it with your hobby, but not anything that you make money with. First of all, no one has an incentive to cooperate, because generally people do these things as part of their work and they try to make money with them. And second, if you're using one of these Creative Commons non-commercial licenses, you are saying that something is something that it's not. Okay, so I would like you to notice this and to say to these manufacturers, hey, Why are you using a non-commercial license and calling it open hardware or open source when that license isn't open source at all? It doesn't satisfy probably number 1 and 6 of the open source and open hardware definitions. So I'm the original author of this entire collection of definitions. And the way that that works is I wrote something called the open source definition, and at that time it was called the Debian Free Software Guidelines. And Javier yesterday said that I based on the Four Freedoms of the Free Software Foundation. Actually, I didn't. And first of all, they weren't the Four Freedoms at the time, they were the Three Freedoms. And Richard Stallman had not invented Freedom Zero. And the other thing is that I didn't have a copy. So what we did is we knew what licenses we wanted to work, and we wrote the open source definition to fit the licenses that we were already using. So very definitely the GPL and Richard Stallman had input to that. And I took the result and I mailed it to Richard. Of course, we knew each other. And Richard wrote back and said, that's a very good definition of free software. And he didn't actually suggest that I look at the four freedoms, well, three freedoms. And so to this day, I don't know how and why that happened, but that's the way it happened. We did not copy from Richard. Okay, so getting to why do we want to use these licenses? Well, the bad news is they don't work for most of us. And so this is something we had a question yesterday about, which may have gone by some of you. And it is that all of our open source licenses are built upon copyright. And I'm speaking about this from the perspective of the United States. And usually that works because the United States forces its intellectual property law on all other countries through international treaties that allow cooperation. So, you know, you'll always see there's a new TRIPS or something like that that we're supposed to sign, and each time we give away some intellectual property rights and some of our freedom. And each time your intellectual property law in your country looks more like that of the United States. So I'm going to explain how copyright is defined in the States. It says that copyright doesn't apply to techniques, principles, processes, systems, methods. Okay, and why does it say that? Because all of those things are the domain of patent. Okay, now at one time, this might not have mattered, because when copyright and patent came out, they both had very short terms. The term of copyright in the United States was only 14 years. Okay, what is the term of copyright now, long after you're dead? Okay, the term of copyright in the United States is the author's lifetime plus 95 years, okay? So nothing will go from copyright into the public domain while it is still useful. Why does this happen? Because every 20 years, the film companies get together and extend the treaty another 20 years. You know, so Mickey Mouse will never be out of copyright. Okay, I'm a filmmaker. I apologize for us collectively. So we have this problem that copyright is forever, and patents at least are still only 21 years. Okay, that's also longer than it used to be. So say that you create software And in your software, you write a new version of how to sort things, okay? The way that you wrote that program is copyrighted, but the new method of how to sort things is not copyrighted. If you want to protect that method from having other people use it, you must patent it, okay? So we get to the point that people start realizing from this, some of your software is copyrightable and some isn't. And in general, any time that there's only one way to do things, it's not copyrightable. It's what we call functional, and functional things are the domain of patent rather than copyright. So in general, up until now, of course, industry is always pushing to make copyright cover more things. Up until now, APIs are not copyrightable. We just had another trial about that in the United States. Interfaces, in general, what you would find in a header is not copyrightable in your software. Now, when we get to schematics, what is in the schematic is entirely functional, okay? So in general, we consider that schematics are the domain of patent and not of copyright. So now you apply, you've drawn this wonderful open hardware schematic, and you apply to it the GPL because you're a good free software person, or you apply to it the CERN OHL or the Tapper license, or if you're making a mistake, a Creative Commons license. And you think now that people won't be able to manufacture versions of your thing without contributing their modifications back to you. Okay, so what do you actually have a copyright on? The paper schematic. Okay, so if someone who wants to make money from your open hardware makes a modification, if they were to publish their paper schematic, they might actually have to comply with your license. But if they don't publish their paper schematic, they don't have to comply with anything. And they can make as many as they want, and they can make all the modifications that they want, and you lose, okay? So open hardware is not supported by the law, as well as perhaps we would like it to be. But what if it was? Okay, what if hardware designs were copyrightable? Well, go to the library and look up a hardware design. After all, we have all these hardware designs going back to the original radio magazines in the 1920s. Now, they're all copyrighted, and you can't use them anymore. Okay, so we don't want to get in a situation where our licenses work better at the cost of hardware designs in general being copyrighted. If that happens, freedom loses, okay? So we, the open hardware people, are in a conundrum, okay? I like he uses conundrum. I don't know if there's even a Portuguese translation of that. And so we don't have licenses that work as well as we would like, and if they worked better, it would hurt freedom, okay? So what do we do? Well, one thing that we can do is get a patent, because suddenly our licenses actually work if we have patents. Okay, but it is not a good thing for us to go patenting our hardware designs. We want to put them in the public instead. So we don't do that. The other thing is it's rather expensive to get a patent. So what I suggest is that we treat our open hardware designs as if they were in the public domain, okay? Because if we believe that our actual hardware design is in the public domain, we won't be disappointed, because that's the way the law actually works. And if you want to copyright and license your document, you may do so. But make sure it's always in your mind that that is only your document. So I'm in a bad place here, because I actually helped make some of these open hardware licenses, but I do not want to deceive you that they work, because if I do, maybe your business fails, maybe you're damaged, maybe you're just disappointed and you don't make open hardware anymore. So this struck me so badly that I did not evangelize open hardware for 2 or 3 years until I figured out what to do about it. Now Javier is going to tell you that it's not quite as bad a deal as all this, and so go on.
Thank you, Bruce. So yes, we are going to have to agree to disagree. Did you want to say something? Maybe she can get a microphone.
Hello. I want to know your opinion about projects that start like open to community to help, like MakerBot, and that Brett Pettis is the founder. He started open, but then when the market absorbed his solutions, he closed and as if it's his own. What do you think about this?
Mm-hmm. So I understood part of that.
Okay. Yes. Do you want to answer that? So she wants to know our opinion about cases like MakerBot, where a company starts as an open source company with an open source design and later decides to close the design and to initiate another phase of their journey as a proprietary company. Okay, I can give you my opinion, and maybe Bruce afterwards can complete that. And I will not forget to answer to you about the CERN Open Hardware License. So, as I said before, I believe in a customer-driven change of paradigm in open hardware, or in hardware in general. And if these people hold the copyright and all the rights to their designs that they had, they are legally capable of changing the license and starting a proprietary business with those design files. That's a perfectly legal thing to do. What I would do as a customer is I would probably not buy that new product if openness was important to me. I have a 3D printer at home and it's an open source one. And it was important for me to have it be open source hardware. So I make no judgment on what people do with their company. I just vote with my wallet, and I foresee that more and more people will find it useful for them to purchase open source hardware, and then that will be probably an incentive for companies to go the open source hardware way, and if they're already there, to not change to proprietary.
So I was struck by something you said yesterday, which was that the old Latin definition of idiot was a person who was not, what?
Greek
definition of idiot was a person who was not interested in politics, because politics is actually as important as the air you breathe, because it determines so much about your life. And throughout my participation in open source software, I've had people in audiences say, "Why don't you just shut up and write code?" And, you know, there's also Shut Up and Hack or Shut Up and Design Hardware, etc. And the answer is that policy is important, and that people, if you are a person who can speak like me, you know, I'm 59 years old and I'm not going to do these talks forever, so we need more of you. We need more of you right now because I can't be everywhere. Please be interested in policy and talk about policy and write about policy, because the people around you don't necessarily understand it and they would like to know. And something also that people write to me all the time, thank you for stating this because I wanted to explain it to my friend and I didn't have the words. So those of you who have the gift to speak and write, please get to understand policy and let your opinion be known wherever you can publish it. So what do we do about MakerBot? Well, let's talk about it first from a legal perspective. First of all, for the reasons I just explained in my long previous answer, if something wasn't patented, they were free to run away with it. Not that it's nice. So what do we revile them for? What do we do to say MakerBot's bad? Well, if they took people's work and they then went private, even though it was legal, it's still not nice. And if they promoted themselves as an open source company and got lots of investment and lots of buy-in and you went and bought their products, and then one day they said, oh, not anymore. Well, that's bad too. And that's a reason that you, as the technical person that people talk to, should not recommend that product, okay? People in your company ask you about things. Even your neighbors, you know, they want to get a 3D printer for their kid for Christmas. Don't tell a MakerBot. It's too expensive anyway. And so I really do believe in voting with your feet and voting with your wallet, and that when there's a company that does right by the community, you should evangelize doing business with that company where you work and any other way that you can. And the day that they stop being good neighbors, stop doing that. And I think that you as technical people don't always realize your power. But who was it who got people to use Red Hat in so many companies? It was always the closet Linux geek, and people knew in the company that he was the closet Linux geek, and one day he became the official company Linux expert. So this will happen for you as well. Now, all of that said, I don't make myself broke doing this. Javier does not make himself broke doing this. He works for a public entity. And I do not recommend that any of you make yourselves broke. And if that means that something can't be fully open hardware, I would like you to make that decision at the start of the existence of your company, if at all possible, rather than starting up and saying we'll be open hardware and then pulling the rug out from under the community afterwards. Well, sometimes that doesn't work out. You can't go on without closing something. So to that extent, I understand, and my own company makes my radio design not entirely open hardware because of that problem. And we will at some point place it into open hardware, but that will be beyond the point where manufacturers of Chinese clothes can hurt our business, and we will make lots of other things open hardware while we're in that business also.
I want to go back to the last question.
Sure.
Just to remind, to go back to the questions that were open, like the provocation that Bruce made about the possibility of we all feeling having the open heart in the public domain. So I think we could return to this question.
I don't want to bore you too much, but section 4.2 of the section 4.1 of the CERN Open Hardware License says the following: the licensee may manufacture or distribute products always, provided that where such manufacture or distribution requires a license under this license, the licensee provides to each recipient of such products an easy means of accessing a copy of the documentation or modified documentation as applicable, as set out in section 3. So, this is conclusive proof of one thing. It is proof that there is at least one lawyer in the world who believes that there is at least one case in the world of hardware in which that manufacturer would require a license. Okay? That's proven. There's at least one lawyer that believes that. Now, as Bruce said, and he is right, this is far from what we have in the world of software. In the world of software, yes?
It's actually not proof. It's only proof he made you believe it.
Okay.
And if all lawyers agreed, we'd have no need for courts.
Yes. So I can tell you, and you will have to believe this at face value, that there are many more lawyers who believe that there's at least one case, and some of them believe there's many more than one case. In particular, there are many lawyers and legal scholars even who have written articles on the particular case of 3D printing, 3D printed pieces of hardware, okay? Saying that that is reproduction under copyright law, that printing a 3D printed piece of hardware is reproduction in the sense of copyright. Now, this CERN Open Hardware License does not assume and does not explicitly mention on which rights it is based. It could be copyright, it could be design rights in the UK, for example. It could be a number of other things. But it is true, and I agree with Bruce on this, that this, because copyleft has been so successful in the software world, and because we have officially stated in the CERN Open Hardware License that it is our aim to achieve something like that, this can be misleading. I agree that the reach, the degree of control which we have in the hardware world regarding manufacturing and distribution of products is vastly inferior to what we have in terms of distribution of binaries in the software world. And I agree, because this is something that I believe you had as a question afterwards, that we should make a special effort to make people aware of that, maybe in a piece of text sitting next to the license that explains what this means, what you can achieve and what you cannot achieve with this license, or what you can expect to achieve with this license today. So it is very important that people don't start out with the wrong expectations. And it is important, as Bruce said, because people are, they have high stakes in this. Owners of companies are risking a lot. When they choose a license, they need to be aware of what it is that they are getting into. So I disagree on some things. The blanket statement that open hardware licenses don't work. They do work for a number of things, but I agree on the general message that there is a risk that people have expectations which are not fulfilled because people know copyleft in software, and copyleft is huge and has been hugely successful. And people might expect copyleft or persistent licenses in the open hardware world to behave the same, and it will not be the same.
So I'll just differ with one thing that Javier said, which is about 3D printing. Is the 3D print, the physical object, a copy of the, what was it, P code? Or is it something separate? Is it a shape? And is that shape the domain of patent rather than copyright? Well, we have a legal equivalent of this in two dimensions, at least in the States. I'm not sure how it goes in Brazil. And that is the difference between fonts and typefaces. Okay, so a typeface is the shape of a letter. And you can define all of these letter shapes. And then when you put them together into something that makes that print on your computer, that is a software program called a font. Okay, a font is copyrightable, but the actual letter shapes are not. And the letter shapes are the subject of a design patent. Okay, so I do testify in court cases. That's part of how I make my living, and when necessary, I do it for free as well. When there's a case like this, I offer to do it for free because how the case comes out is very important to me. And so I hope that when this gets to court, I will get to be in court and describe how this has already been decided for fonts and typefaces, and that 3D printing, just having one more dimension, should not be any different. And it may be that the judge agrees with me, and perhaps the judge will not.
I'm sorry, I have to say, I know you love to disagree with me, but you cannot disagree on what I said, which is that some scholars say that printing a piece of hardware in a 3D printer is reproduction in the copyright sense. And I have articles for you that I can share. Of course, these scholars are as aware as you about what a font is and what the difference with the typeface is, and they still seem to believe that that 3D printing is reproduction. I make no claims myself. I don't testify in court, and I am not a legal expert, so I don't make that kind of claim that I believe this or that. I just say that some legal scholars believe it and write it in articles. So, yeah.
So, there's an extra catch with 3D printers, which is some people use, not everybody, but some people, for instance, the RedRap project, which was the project based on which MakerBot started their own printers.
And all these Prusas.
And yeah, exactly. The Prusa was about using a 3D modeling scripting language. So the source code that describes the algorithmic construction of the 3D models was licensed under GPL, if I'm not mistaken. So that algorithmic description, that specific way of doing things, is bound to copyright, of course, but the end result, not necessarily, and I tend to understand that it's not. But then when RepRap was adapted into a MakerBot machine, they replaced the 3D printed parts by some other manufacturing technique by using laser cutting pieces of wood. So they replaced those parts with other parts that were functionally equivalent or similar. And so there's there's no legal copyright link between them, the projects, even though it's basically doing the same thing with a different technique. So even though I really hate what MakerBot did, and back then, I ran a company, we used to produce 3D printers here in Brazil, and we produced like 150 units, and it was also based on the RapRap project. And so back then, I really, really hated what happened, because I felt that MakerBot was a very nice example and inspiration for me opening my own company. But then I felt that I could not trust them anymore as a guiding example. But even though I do not like that, I cannot say they are doing anything illegal with what they did because of that copyright understanding.
Yeah. Let me take that for a moment. So there's something I'll do with my customers in court, and before we get to court. And the way to explain this is I'm someone who helps attorney. I'm not an attorney myself. I advise the lawyer. And so the lawyer is the person who actually has a license to do law. So I'm not representing myself as a lawyer. But what I will advise them is if there's a question, and if it will cost a lot to argue the question in the courtroom, then we avoid it, okay? So it may have been that sort of situation for MakerBot, where they knew that if they actually went to court after copying the RepRap design, that they would win, but they did not want to spend what it took to win. And that's an absolutely valid thing to do, because arguing in a court could cost $5 or $10 million. And when I help these people, I am billing $7.50 every minute. And the lawyers cost more. So it's a very expensive process, and you just avoid it if at all possible. And now you know how I can make so much open source and open hardware, by the way. And so, you know, I'm not apologizing for RepRap. They could do what they could do, but it doesn't feel right anyway.
Yeah, maybe some other question? Okay, maybe I can also comment on something that I told Bruce the other day. I have, of course, a very naive view on law. I'm not a legal scholar, I'm not a lawyer, but there are some things that don't sound right from a common sense perspective. If I take a document and I print it in my paper printer, and I send the sheets of paper out, I distribute it, or I sell it, then I am subject to copyright law. If I take another document and I print it in my 3D printer, really thin, maybe 2 millimeters in plastic, I'm not using toner anymore, I'm not using ink anymore, I'm using plastic, and then I sell that, that doesn't count as reproduction. So, according to some, so I make that thinner and thinner and thinner until I get as thin as paper. And would that then be reproduction? I mean, there's something, in my opinion, there's a bit of the legal world not catching up with the evolution of technology, in my opinion. I believe more and more that hardware and software are very, very much alike. We have many examples. I just gave one, but there is also hardware description languages. There are pieces of code. You write them with Emacs or Vi, actually, as you would type C++ or Java. And then, depending on what you do with those sources, they can actually behave as software if you feed them to a simulator, or they can end up being an integrated circuit if you target the same sources at the production line of silicon. So for me, it looks like It might be that the legal world just has not caught up with the notion that there is sources, and then these sources become something, and that is what happens in both software and hardware, and that maybe these big distinctions with the laws that are applied in the two cases are a thing of the past, when they were really very different.
So I'm not going to keep you here all night by continuing to argue this question with Javier, although I could actually do it. So we'll go on to the next question.
We can also jump to questions between yourselves.
Do you want to do that?
Yeah, I want to hear Bruce. I have questions for,
okay.
For Bruce. So can you go down to my questions? I think they are written there. I'm actually more interested in another one about, yes, that one. So about the extent of copyright. Okay, this is, of course, now I'm very interested in this because people who are advocates of copyleft, and of course we all love copyleft because it has done wonderful things, right? And there's no doubt about it. But they are concerned, and we had Alexandra yesterday here, in the morning, he was also concerned with the growing scope of copyright. Now my question to these people in general is, so copyleft only exists because copyright exists, right? But copyleft has done so many great things. So my question is, if you had to choose between a world with no copyright and hence no copyleft, and a world with copyright and copyleft, what would you choose? And then there are corollaries in this question, which are related, like, you know, the Linux versus free BSD. We have seen the success of Linux. Do you think that the success of Linux is mostly due to it being copyleft? And do you think that in a world without copyright and copyleft, these companies which have invested so much in Linux would have invested so much? Long question, sorry.
So I'm going to step a meta level up from Javier's question and give the answer which he did not expect, which is that I would choose a world in which there was not a downside to sharing. And what that means is that I would choose a world where you could invest your time in making a development and give it to others, and that your family would still be able to eat and pay the rent. Now, unfortunately, no one has created the communist paradise in which I can create free software and give it away, and my family still gets a nice lifestyle. So we have to compromise. And when I am talking about law, I will also be compromising because we will have arguments about law where I do my very best to fit in the present framework of law, to be incremental in changes to the law, rather than just throw out the whole thing and start again. Although sometimes it would be better to do just that. So if we look at Richard Stallman's story about how he founded the GNU project, Richard was upset because there was a problem with a printer, and he wanted to fix the printer, and he asked for the source code, and the manufacturer could not give it to him because he was copyrighted. Richard, being a little physically different from everyone else, decided to devote his entire life to solving that problem. And so the free software movement, to a great extent, is a rebellion against copyright. And people don't realize that. Now, it happens that Richard had to work within the framework of existing law. He couldn't all take us to Mars and found the communist paradise. So he used the law to implement copier left, but it is really only an accident that the law worked for implementing copy left. And in fact, when open source and free software were more in their infancy, I had many lawyers objecting to the entire idea because they felt that the making of a profit from your work was inherent in the entire framework of copyright and patent law. And it was only after judges said otherwise that people actually accepted open source licenses as legal. And if you look at the cases where that happened, for example, a case that I worked on called Jacobson versus Katzer, the judge accepted my argument that although the open source developer was not paid, he got benefit from his work. He got publicity, he got people who hired him, he got more software, etc. So only because there was this exchange, an economic exchange, even though it was not in money, did the judge find the open source license legal. Okay, so I think it's really just an accident that copyleft could be implemented in copyright at all, and I don't feel that extension of copyright is a thing that's to our advantage. I don't feel in general that any extension of intellectual property except concerning your personal privacy, okay? You should own the facts about yourself. The fact is that you don't. Okay, but other than that, I don't think intellectual property law helps us as a society if we extend it anymore. Okay, so Linux versus FreeBSD, would we have a good Linux kernel if copyleft did not exist? It may be an accident that we have Linux as the dominant one rather than FreeBSD, and it may come back to things like Linux had disk controllers that people had in their homes before BSD did. It may be that kind of thing. It may not actually be that the GPL was the catalyst of all this collaboration. It is the case that the GPL influences people to make things free that they might otherwise not have made free. And thus I will put the GPL, or in fact the most restrictive one there is the Afero GPL 3, on all of my software that I can. And in the case of BusyBox, I worked on BusyBox for 1 month, and companies invested years into BusyBox after that. So I know that the copyleft license gives us a reward, but not at the cost, not at the cost of expanding conventional intellectual property law. Now, next, would Red Hat, Google, etc. contribute code to a kernel licensed under a permissive license? Well, we have a compiler that's under a permissive license. It's four letters. What are they?
LLVM.
Yeah, LLVM. So LLVM actually does get quite a lot of open contribution from companies, but you will also find once in a while that a company contributes a GPL'd plugin to LLVM because they don't want commercial and extensions by their competitors. I think even Adobe did that. And there are also companies that make proprietary plugins to LLVM. Well, would they have made them free otherwise? Maybe they would have. And also there's Apache. You know, Apache has quite a lot of contribution, but the Java world seems to be getting farther and farther from everyone else all the time, and it's sort of taking Apache with it. So I don't know if that will keep on being the case.
So maybe now one question from Bruce to Javier.
Okay, so... Yeah.
You presented apparently false dichotomy by giving just two options, like all or nothing, in regards to copyright. But I would like to remind of a suggestion that was brought up by Stalin, that maybe the ideal would be to have a very reduced amount of time with copyright, like 5 years, because no copyright at all would make free software to be in a huge disadvantage in comparison to whoever might want to instantly reappropriate the public domain and not simply not publish with secret instead of copyright, right? If you don't publish the source code, even if you don't have a law supporting it, your secrecy, it's still secret and hard to reverse engineering and so on. So a short amount of time would enable copyleft, and that amount of time and would be maybe better than no copyright at all. And a second option that was suggested was an escrow, like a copy of the source code in the Library of Congress, so that you have certainty that after the proprietary software falls into public domain, within like a short time, still being useful and not really obsolete software, you would have the guarantee that the source code is available and not still kept in secret.
Okay, so I'll be sure to give the mic to Javier after this, but I dual license my own software, and that is part of having companies that don't like the GPL to have a way to work with it, and those companies pay me and I take the money and I make more free software. The same work is licensed under commercial license and the Affero GPL 3. And the company that pays me, they may have their own extension that's not free software. But they're not breaking the GPL, they're doing it under my separate terms. There's complication in doing this. You have to have the entire copyright or the right to relicense. So you have to have a contributor agreement, and I also give things back to my contributors. I tell my contributors, I will keep developing this as free software for 3 years, or I'll take your contribution out, so that they don't feel that I will run away and do what MakerBot did, you know, right away, that they will have 3 years of my work in exchange for their contribution. So I think that works. It works really well for everyone, and I think that more people should explore dual licensing software. I have also written letters of support. These people were customers, but I won't give a customer a report supporting them if I think it's unethical for me to do so. There have been cases where I've just told the customer, no, I can't support this, there won't be any charge, thank you. And so in two cases so far, I've written one that supports a company that makes something that's under a non-open source license and eventually makes it open source on a timer. Okay, my finding in my report was that that was beneficial to open source, and that they were able to support themselves, and that it wasn't really fair to ask them to be waiters while they wrote free software. And the other company I was a little less happy with, but I supported them. They distribute GPL software to their customers, and their customers do not redistribute. They don't ask them, they just don't redistribute. And then they put it up on the internet 9 months later. So they have this premium version that's essentially under GPL and is undistributed except to their customers. And then it goes to be explicitly public. And I wrote a letter that explained the problems with that model. Like if one of their customers put the software up online, they'd have to find a new model. But that it was ultimately beneficial. And again, I'm telling you all, don't go broke and don't be a chump that people take advantage of. Figure out how to do what you want and have your cake and eat it.
Okay, so now one question from Bruce to Javier.
Okay. So I think we were just there. Okay.
You can choose.
Oh, well, that one I think you answered.
Yes.
Okay, so, oh, here's an interesting one. Do you think the developers should provide the Gerber files? Should they make it possible for people to directly copy their printed circuit boards? Should they provide the bill of materials? Should they, in other words, just enable what I would call the Chinese cloner to subvert their own business if they have one? And in what cases should they do that? In what cases is it a good idea and a bad idea?
I don't see, again, I keep coming to this argument, but I don't see such a big difference with free software in this case. I mean, there is this thing that we have defined, which is open source hardware, where there's a number of freedoms that get guaranteed, like the freedom to study, the freedom to modify, the freedom to manufacture, and to sell the results, both design or hardware. All these things are free to do for people who get an open source hardware design. So you wouldn't qualify. Well, first of all, I have to say, typically for those of you who don't do electronics, people draw schematics with the symbols, then they create a netlist, and they go to the layout tool. The layout tool is when you start moving tracks and moving footprints, things that are going to eventually be copper in your printed circuit board. That's the layout, and there's a lot of hours invested into layout in many circuits. Okay, and then at the end of that layout effort, you click on a button, you create a Gerber file that will be the manufacturing file. So I guess what you mean here is more the layout. I get if you don't release the layout, I don't think you can call it open source hardware, basically, because you're not allowing people to change the hardware design and manufacture a variant of that design. Now, the question is rather, so I think we all agree that that wouldn't be open hardware. The question is rather, should people do it? And my answer is, it's up to them in the same sense as when it's a piece of software. Do you provide to your competitors everything they need to build your software and to sell services based on that? Or don't you? And here, again, I respect a lot the decision of whoever it is that whose money is at stake. I would never tell somebody if they must do open source hardware or not. And this is the question, in my opinion, that's being asked here.
What do we want to do now?
How about going to back to one question that looks for the future? Like the last question that we did.
Any comment? Yeah, there? At the back?
Guns.
Oh, okay. Oh yeah, we'll definitely do that question.
Okay, so maybe on the next, okay. This is one question that you can plan for what you want to the future. What are the main challenges of open hardware initiatives for the next 3 years?
So, I answered that in my talk yesterday, but for those who weren't here, I think we need to do two things. One is the tools. We need good, high quality, fully featured, free software tools to design hardware, because if we're in the business of sharing, we can barely call sharing when we publish design files, which need a given proprietary tool that not everybody has access to be studied, edited, modified, and shared back. So we, in my opinion, we need to make a big effort on the tools for developing hardware. That includes PCB design, it includes HDL simulators, simulators for hardware description languages like VHDL and Verilog, synthesis tools, but there we're getting into a domain where we will need the collaboration of the FPGA vendors and maybe the ASIC library vendors as well. And place and route and everything that takes you to an FPGA, to a field programmable gate array bitstream. So that's just examples of tools that we would need to be to exist in a free and open source software way. And the other thing we need, in my opinion, is to get organized, because many people have proven in the past that getting organized pays. And in particular, our constant source of inspiration, which is free software, has organizations like the Free Software Foundation. You have great examples of big collaborations like the Debian Project, which have achieved incredible things because they were organized. And if we want to tackle these big problems, like the tools, but not only the tools, any others that we have in front of us, we will need to get organized.
So I want to narrow this to the question about gate arrays. And I don't believe that we are going to get the gate array manufacturers to cooperate with us to the extent that it's really necessary for us to make good open hardware. And the problem with this has been that they do not document the bit stream which is used to program their gate arrays and to debug it, because they feel that by doing so, they would reveal too much about the internals of their gate arrays. And there is a solution for this, which I would love to work on. And I would love for somebody to give me a grant to do it, in fact. And, you know, I do it with good electrical engineers. And the solution is for us to manufacture an open hardware gate array. And this would be a gate array for which the entire internals of the device and the bitstream are publicly documented. Once we had such a device, making the software tools for manipulating it no longer has the barriers, because the basic problem, the lack of documentation of the actual physical device, has gone away. I also believe that once we had such a device, that it would be produced, because just as people produce clones of the Arduino and sell them for next to nothing on eBay and still make a profit, that people would produce this kind of gate array. They would market it as one compliant to our standards, which we would define. We would be able to test it and certify it, and they would compete with each other to make the price as low as possible. So having made a reasonably practical gate array with an acceptable speed and an acceptable size, I think that it would prove so interesting to many people in the sciences and technologies that from then on we would have the community and support to make bigger and more powerful gate arrays and peripherals and buses and entire CPUs and things that we have just not thought about today. And it needs money to bootstrap it.
A nice crowdfunding company.
Sorry?
We'll
see about the patent minefield there, but okay, that's another issue. Do you want to go to the guns or?
I like this question because you start to agree, you know?
It's good.
But I want to, do you have any reference? Is there a FPGA initiative with an organization to get more, let's say, friends to work in, or already know how to start it?
I know there have been FPGA designs done by people during their PhD thesis. I know that. They have not been commercialized, and maybe that's an indication that there are other obstacles than the knowledge. The knowledge is there. People know how to design FPGAs. That's for sure. I know even someone who did it at CERN, because at CERN we need to have chips which withstand a certain amount of radiation when they are installed near the accelerators. So he had a good reason. He wanted a bit of flexibility, and he wanted this chip to withstand radiation. So there was a good reason to do that or to explore that. It was not manufactured in the end. So for me, the fact that it hasn't been done yet reveals maybe two things. One is that ASIC design or chip design in general is not completely democratized yet. There are a couple of initiatives, very promising, like the low-risk processor, the system on chip being designed in Cambridge or as an international collaboration, very promising, and they are actually going for manufacture in volume of silicon. This is really great, and it's, to my knowledge, the first time this is happening, this type of thing is happening. So there should be, in principle, no problem to do that, but it's maybe a bit early. The other thing is the patent minefield. I don't know. I don't have enough information, but something tells me that whoever designs an FPGA of a certain degree of performance is going to be necessarily running into some patents that are held by the big players in that domain.
We will indeed have to look at what patents have already expired. The fact is, we've had gate arrays for about 21 years now, and thus the fundamental technology of them probably has gone into the public domain, but there will be advances in design which perhaps we'll have to circumvent and make other ways of doing things. And unfortunately, patent working around patents and understanding the patents and perhaps even having legal advice will be a necessity for this project, and will make it more expensive because of that. Now, that said, how do you start? Okay, before you even get any money to do this, the way that you start is you design a gate array in a gate array, okay? Because we all have these $50 Papillon ones and things like that that we can buy that allow us to program gate arrays. So you can develop the entire architecture of your gate array and its bitstream as digital logic in VHDL. Now, the question after that is, well, what's the next step? The next step is we take that and we actually make it into discrete transistors that are on a piece of silicon rather than logical elements, and that there will be work for electrical engineers to do that, and that there will indeed be tuning of every process when you go to a fab. Okay, so the actual end result is harder than programming something into a gate array, but we can get a good way there by starting that way. And if you are the kind of logical designer who can do this sort of work, well, go home and start tomorrow and see how far you get. Well,
how do we gather the big kind of business?
So
isn't there, I guess, things like, I think nobody talked about open compute here, but then there's clearly big capital that is being pushed into that kind of issue, because there's some kind of value that can be extracted from that issue. such an FPGA initiative could potentially bring lots of big capital interest, but how do we gather a set of big corporations that might be interested in not having to rely on the current FPGA providers, the current incumbents?
So I think it has to be an academic initiative, and because we can make quite a good educational case for doing this, for giving people who are learning digital logic design all of the internals of the actual device that they're programming. Just as you know personally that people who were in operating systems courses in the 70s and 80s only wrote simulations of operating systems because they didn't have the BSD, OS, or Linux. Okay, and now they don't have to write simulated operating systems in their classes. They can do the real thing. Well, we would be allowing people in an educational setting to get that much closer to the hardware. So I think we can make a really good educational case. And we need to work with people in academia on actually asking for grants and making this perhaps an international grant-based effort.
It doesn't seem that grants reach the level of money necessary for the actual fabrication.
Well, they're repeated. If you go the first step, you generally can get a grant for the next step. But it's a big project. You have to look at how big science works. Mr. Big Science himself.
You might also get commercial partners that, as I said yesterday in my talk, will walk a part of the path with you. In the case of the low-risk people, it looks like Google is interested, maybe because they would like to have more choices to equip their servers. And they are contributing to this project. So I don't know exactly how the finances are done in the low-risk project, but I know they want to do silicon in volume, and I know Google is a partner in that project.
Do we want to do the guns and let them go home?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, guns. This is a question, tricky question. So how does it read? Yes, are open source firearms good for society? I say open source is good and firearms are bad. This is my opinion. Now, I think undiscriminate, uncontrolled distribution and exchange of firearms, I am personally against. Of course, I'm not representing anybody but myself here. So I'm very happy to live in a country where open source licenses are allowed and even encouraged in many places, and the exchange and distribution of firearms is very, very tightly controlled. That's all I can say. The combination of the two would be bad in my opinion, because any exchange of firearms, being open source or proprietary, I just don't like it. So that's just my personal opinion.
So I was actually at a flea market last month, and there was someone selling a 3D printed lower register for an AR-15. In other words, a major mechanical component of a assault weapon, not a hunting weapon, a weapon that is made to kill people in volume. I wasn't very happy to see this, and I sort of suspected that this might have been open hardware. And we have various situations in which people hunt and eat the meat. We have situations in which, well, maybe someday to survive you might have to hunt and eat the meat. And so I cannot entirely condemn a firearm, and I cannot entirely condemn making open hardware for a firearm, but I vehemently condemn to the day of my death making firearms whose main purpose is the killing of human beings rather than the hunting of animals. I don't think there's a reason for people to be making open source handguns that can actually fire a few times before they kill their developer. They're plastic, after all. And I condemn the people who are doing that. I'm sorry. I don't think you are helping our cause. I think you're hurting our cause, and you are making it, we'll get to you, you are making it more likely that people will enact restrictions on what you can do with a 3D printer. Because a 3D printer has now become more than just a thing for making tools. It has become a weapon lathe, a special lathe used for making weapon barrels. So no, I'm not friends of these guys. And the lady there has a question.
Okay, the question is, should all science be open? Because some of the research might not lead to a fire gun, but might lead to other kinds of killing machines, or, I don't know, all kinds of ways of killing people, or the nature, or this stuff. So it should be open, every kind of research.
This is, in fact, a very similar question, right?
I wanted to say
some research, they don't intend to kill people, but they might, as the plans of Saint-Simon.
Yes.
what I wanted to say regarding this question, which also applies partly to your case, is something that we have not discussed, but it's very important. It's the difference between license and the law. License is something that any person can write and publish. It's a document that says, hopefully based on law as well, based on an underlying set of rights and so on, but it's something that is not voted by a parliament, for example. Okay? And then the law is something which is above whatever a license says, okay, in such a way that for the case of the fire gun, somebody might read the license and say, yes, I have the right to distribute. The license gives me the right to distribute. But in fact, there is a law that says you cannot distribute firearms freely. And the law wins. The law, if there is a contradiction between license and the law wins because it has been voted in parliament. Similarly, for science, we have tools to make that science open. I talked about open data yesterday. There are places where you upload all your scripts, all the description of your apparatus, all the acquisition data in such a way that you make it as easy as possible to reproduce that science. Okay, so we have all the instruments in the world to make the science open if we judge it to be a good thing. And then there are higher decisions made by governments as to whether those tools should be used in a particular situation or not. I cannot make a blanket statement about research. Those are things which are not in the, in my opinion, you have to decide it on a case-by-case basis and with the legitimacy that the votes of the people give to you.
So this is not a hollow question for Brazil, because I understand that the gun nuttiness of the United States has spread to Brazil. And I think this is a question in what we find socially acceptable as societies and what we allow to happen. I think that we're not being effective as political entities in suppressing what I fully believe is a very reprehensible activity. We're going way out of open source and open hardware to political science and things where I have no further expertise. There are other similar questions. You can research into poisons that kill people. We now have open hardware genetic engineering for you to create new diseases. None of these things are socially acceptable, and I believe there should indeed be legal restrictions against their deployment. Just as we restrict biological researchers very carefully in how things get released. So I think the question is really not for us anymore, but it is for what we expect of our politicians, technically. And the fact is that they're not all that technical, and that they need us talking to them, and they need more people like us actually going into politics. So this again, you know, there are very many young faces out here, and I hope that some of you can do just that.
I fully agree with Bruce on this one. A decision in some government can change things much more than the concerted efforts of thousands of people working at another layer. I knew a professor of philosophy in Paris who told me he had written a book so that one person would read it. It was somebody who was in the Ministry of Education. So it is very important that our representatives get faithful information of, that they should understand before taking decisions, and many of us can help in that. Yeah, somebody else?
Alguma pergunta mais? Mais uma pergunta? Ok, so this last question, última pergunta, para a gente encerrar.
Today, in one of the most important media, of business media of Brazil, they said that there is this program of called CI Brazil, which was created to develop microelectronic in Brazil 6 years ago. It's been shutting down because it didn't work out. They dependent on government investment. It's a program for all over the country. And we want to know, they don't work in the open source projects. We want to know what mistake can they have made for this to happen. Because we don't know if it's lack of entrepreneurs, lack of, or too much dependence on government investment.
Yes, so the question is about this program for making microelectronics in Brazil that was cut because it was not profitable, and whether we have an idea of what they could have done wrong for it not to succeed. I'm sorry, I don't know anything about that case. What I do know is that some governments are more prone to stopping open source initiatives or to stopping scientific research initiatives and so on. So, and the only way of having more of that, more open source backed by the government and more scientific research, public research, is to vote for people who defend that. But about this particular case, I cannot make any concrete comment.
Well, here I go talking about a particular national project of which I'm entirely ignorant, but money talks in politics, and we find that initiatives are sometimes derailed by our favorite software company, who has quite a lot of political lobbies everywhere we go, has entire organizations such as CompTIA, who sometimes work on their behalf, and for the hardware manufacturers, it is no different. So it may well be that a Brazilian hardware manufacturing initiative gains objection from international hardware manufacturing companies, which can put quite a lot of money into politics. We also see these projects being defamed. We see misleading articles being placed in the news about them quite regularly to create political opposition. And we know that there are people whose full-time employment is getting this sort of article placed in the press. So there are quite a few obstacles in our way for a national initiative of this type. And sometimes the very best thing to do to make this happen has been to do it in a smaller organization within your nation, which does not actually have that much publicity and which has funding sources that are not incredibly beholden to politics such that they change with every election. So in many cases, you can do this sort of under the radar in an intellectual, educational or a corporate setting, rather than having it happen in government. The other thing that has struck me is a number of nations have implemented their own open source centers. For example, Norway, where I taught, got its own open source center, and the founder promised me up and down that the open source center would be used to promote open source rather than manage open source. But I noticed that the educational institutions who are the ones on the board of the center have been pushing it in the direction of perhaps not promoting open source everywhere that they should. There's very much pressure on that sort of institution to not rock the boat, because rocking the boat makes you political enemies, you know, gets people fired from their positions because they become political embarrassments. All sorts of behind-the-scenes negotiation goes on. So it's a very difficult thing to do, and my fallback has always been to do it in a small organization and to do it behind the radar and not, to do it under the radar and not for it to be any kind of national initiative at all.
Okay, yeah, you can move now. And I'd like to thank the name of the organizers for Bruce and Javier accepting to be here. It was very tough to get all the paperwork for Bruce. And I'd like to thank the UNESCO and IBCD, UIPIC, that provided funding for bringing Bruce here. So it was a pleasure to have this very nice and enlightening conversation between both of you. Food for thought. Yeah, for different points of view and a lot of alike several issues. So thank you very much, and I hope we can all have a good night.
You have to stand and shake hands.